heat cell and tube heat exchanger is most widely used in the process industries because it will give a efficient heat exchange. So because of its design procedure, TEMA is Tubular Heat Exchanger Manufacturer Association. So that has established well designed procedure to design cell and tube heat exchanger. Therefore, we always design a good cell and tube heat exchanger. So therefore, it is always the best choice if you are searching for a heat exchanger. If you search for heat exchanger, then I'll say cell and tube heat exchanger is the best. So it is consisting of tubes and which are held in a tube seat, and tube seat will get drill the hole. Through the hole will pass the tubes, and the tube seat is consisting of baffle. Baffles will be giving a specific path of baffle is giving a specific path to the process fluid which is flowing through the cell side. And also there are tie rods which will be giving a mechanical strength to the heat exchanger. Okay, I'll try to show. Okay, 1 minute, I'll show. Still people are joining, 1 minute. I'll share once again. Okay, can you see this one? Can you see the slide, shared page? Can you see the shared page or not? Yes or no? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so this is, you can see here, this is a tube which will be inside, and this is a tube seat which will be held by, okay, these two tube seat, and this is the process fluid which will be going on the tubes. Okay, in the tubes you will pass the fluid from this side. Okay, so therefore you can see here, you can see one of the heat exchanger. So this is a tube seat, this is a tube seat, and then these tube seats are whole, and then these tubes are passed from one tube seat to the other tube seat. So therefore whenever you can see here, there is only the hole are available to enter inside. So therefore, as soon as the process fluid will enter here, this is a tube side inlet. So it is only going through the tubes and it is coming out. Okay. If you see the cell side, okay, cell side fluid is over the tubes. It is flowing on the tubes, and these are the baffles. Okay, you can see here. So if there are no baffles, directly it will go like this. Okay, cross. So therefore, I want to give a specific length. Therefore, I'll have a restriction over the flow here. Therefore, it will be moving this way, you can see here. So therefore, I want to use the entire area of a tube seat. So therefore, what is important here, therefore important is to withstand a specific operation for a given pressure drop. So therefore, you will be having a different pressure drop on a tubes, and you will be having a different pressure drop on a cell. So usually whenever you are dealing with a very very high pressure drop fluid, so try to keep that inside the tube. So therefore, please remember, high pressure fluid will always keep in a tube side. On cell side, you should keep a less pressure fluid. Why? Suppose if in case the tube will rupture, tube will damage, the everything will be inside. It will be constrained in the cell. So there is no damage to the outside world. If people are standing here, if there is a, okay, damage or failure of a cell, the entire fluid will spill over on the floor. So therefore, it will cause a damage to the property as well as the people. So therefore, If it is high pressurized fluid, always keep on the tube side, because high pressurized tubes will be cheaper than high pressurized cell. So because when you use a cell side thickness, you require a large quantity of a material. So you require a large quantity of a material. So therefore, always the cell will costing more as compared to the tubes. So therefore, tubes are relatively cheaper than a cell. And also, suppose if you see here, if this tube is damaged, what I'll do? I'll stop the operation. I'll remove this tube and I'll insert the tube. Suppose cell is damaged, the entire mechanism will go wrong. Then you have to reconstruct the work. So therefore, please remember, when you are dealing with the high pressure fluid, always allocate high pressure fluid in the tubes as compared to the cell, because the high pressure tubes are cheaper than a high pressure cell. Okay, this is one. What is second? Suppose if you are dealing with a corrosive fluid, suppose if you are dealing with a highly concentrated alkalis or highly concentrated acids, then where it should be kept? Suppose if I am keeping on the cell, the entire cell will be get corroded. Definitely you will be going to have a problem. So therefore, again, I will be keeping this in the tube side. So therefore, I'll give a specific length, and then I can select a specific steel tubes or higher alloy steels so that I can prevent the corrosion, because replacement of tubes is easier than replacement of the cell. Okay, this is one. So what is the velocity of the tube? So try to keep a velocity of the tubes greater than one, and also the velocity of the cell is nearly one. So why? So because fouling will occur on the surface of the tube. Fouling is always occurs on the surface of the tube as well as inside the tube. So therefore, if inside the tube the fouling occurs, you can increase the pressure and the fouling can be carried away. Suppose any suspended particles which are accumulated or which are settled in the tubes. Suppose if they are settled in the tubes, what happened? I can overcome by increasing the velocity. I can overcome this by increasing the velocity. As you increase the velocity of the tube, this velocity will carry all the suspended particles present. Okay. And also, if anything is okay accumulated here, suppose the tube side, cell side fluid will be having a suspended particle, these particles will start accumulated here. So they will be accumulated here. So I can overcome by increasing the velocity. When I'll increase the velocity, everything will be get mixed, it will be carried away. So therefore, so this is the velocity, and these are the things you should always remember. Okay, this is all about cell and tube heat exchanger. And you can see here, overpressure protection. As I said, in cell and tube heat exchanger, there is a potential for a tube to rupture and high pressure fluid to enter and overpressurize at a low pressure side heat exchanger. The usual configuration of the heat exchanger is for a high pressure fluid to be in a tubes. Please remember, always keep high pressurized fluid in the tubes and low pressure fluid in the cell side. So therefore, so this is the design consideration always you should have. Okay. So we'll come to the again, I'll share this one. Okay. So we'll start a problem, and then as I am going to the problem, I'll explain each and every step. And Perry handbook is already shared with you. So please download, and I'll explain all the steps here. But how best you will use a Perry handbook is very important, because all the important information we are taking here from the Perry handbook. Okay, please remember. That's here. Okay. So please, all of you, please all of you write this one. Can you see this slide? So this is one of the important problem. Can you see this problem? Yes or no? Yes, sir. Okay. So please, all of you, write this problem. So this is asked repeatedly every semester, alternate question. First time there will be different. Second time this will be sure. Then again fourth. So alternate question paper, you can find this question. Calculate the size of 1-2 heat exchanger. See here. he want to design one two heat exchanger. One is what? One is cell, two is tubes. You have to give one pass on the cell side, two pass on the tube side. So one pass will be given always. So try to keep only one pass on the cell side. Two pass will be more pass, two and more pass will be given on the tube side, because you can increase the velocity by increasing the pass. When you increase the velocity, the number of passes will be increases, or you can, if the velocity is less, that can be overcome by increasing the pass. So therefore, one is cell, two is tubes. One pass on a cell side, two pass on a tube side. Required to cool 66,700. Required to cool 66,700 kg per hour of ethylene glycol. Calculate the size of 1-2 cell and tube heat exchanger required to cool 66,700 kg per hour of ethylene glycol from 120 to 103 degree centigrade, 103 degree centigrade, comma. So please, all of you, write, keep the calculator with you and follow the steps. You can easily learn. It become a practice for you. Okay, please, all of you, write. Using toluene as coolant, using toluene, T-O-U-L-E-N-E, toluene as coolant, comma, which is heated from 27 degree centigrade to 63 degree centigrade, which is heated from 27 degree centigrade to 63 degree centigrade. So please remember, hot fluid will always have a higher inlet temperature. This is a hot, ethylene glycol is hot fluid. It is losing the heat. And if you see, toluene is entering at a lesser temperature and leaving at higher temperature. Cold fluid will always gain a heat. Please remember, hot fluid will lose the heat and cold fluid will gain the heat. Okay, so full stop. Use steel tubes. What is the type of tubes they are using? Steel tube of 14 SWG, Swiss wire gauge, or BWG, Brigham wire gauge, or British wire gauge. So you can use 14 SWG or 14 BWG thickness. So therefore, this will give a thickness to the tube. You have to consider the thickness by referring to the table. I'll show where is this table. Okay. Having outer diameter of 3 by 4 inch. Outer diameter of 3 by 4 inch. This is also given, and also given 19.05 mm. 3 by 4 inch is what? 19.05 mm. Outer diameter of the tube is given. Full stop. The tube having a length in bracket 8 feet. 8 feet is 2.43 meter. 8 feet is 2.43 meters. And are laid on triangular pitch arrangement. And are laid on triangular pitch arrangement. So pitch, I have explained, that is also given. They have laid on a triangular pitch arrangement. And also the pitch is specified. Pitch of 1 inch. Pitch of 1 inch. 1 inch is what? 2.54 centimeter. So it is not a millimeter, it is centimeter. 2.54 centimeter. Sorry. My mistake, I have written. This is a centimeter, 2.54 centimeter. The cell contain 25% cut segmental baffles. Cut segmental baffles. And baffle spacing is 152 mm apart. Apart, full stop. Let the ethylene glycol flow through the tubes. Is that also given? No problem. He is asking you to keep the ethylene glycol on the tube side, since it is more corrosive fluid. Since it is, you can see here, since it is more corrosive fluid, therefore allocate this in the tube side. Number one, design the heat exchanger with all the details. Number two, estimate the pressure drop on each stream. Estimate the pressure drop on each stream. Next is, draw the proportionate sketch of cell and tube heat exchanger. Third, this is a question paper problem. Okay, last year question paper problem. And what is given? Data is given. Density of ethylene glycol. Sorry, ethylene glycol. So it is easy. Density of ethylene glycol is 1045 kg per meter cube. So density is given, okay, and also density of toluene is given. Density of toluene is 842.5 kg per meter cube. Kg per meter cube, okay. Have you finished writing? Then I'll explain. Okay. Have you finished writing of this problem?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, I'll explain. See here, when you design a cell and tube heat exchanger, see here, so don't rush for your design immediately, okay? Try to understand and write the data carefully. So there should be no mistake, and whatever the data you have taken from the problem statement should be, okay, analyzed carefully. So please remember, okay? And see here, calculate the size of 1-2 heat exchanger. So therefore, first step you write, we have to design 1-2 heat exchanger only. Don't design other 1-3, 1-4. No, wrong. Because he want 1-2. If he is not asking, you can design as per your convenience. He is saying you have to design 1-2 heat exchanger. And also identify what is a hot fluid and cold fluid. Hot fluid will be having always the higher temperature. So therefore you can see ethylene glycol is a hot fluid. So therefore, because it is a 120 inlet temperature. And then benzene is a cold fluid because it is entering at 27. Fine. And then what is given? ID of tube is given, 19.05. Only that much is given. Therefore, you have to calculate OD of tube is given. You have to calculate ID of tube. Tube length is also given. Length of tube is also given. And tubes are arranged in a triangular pitch. And then baffle spacing is 159. And then, so density is given. And density of toluene is given. So therefore, try to read carefully, write down the data, and okay, what you want to do. So decide and then proceed further. Okay. I hope you have written this problem. We'll see the step by step. What is the first step? First step is work out with your temperature. Work out. See here. So write down, draw this. Okay. He asking you to design 1-2 heat exchanger. See here. When you draw, here I'll show once again. So please all of you draw along with me so that you can understand. See here. So this is the cell. Okay, I'll show. First you draw like this. Okay, I'll show how to increase the pass. Okay, usually this is the notation of cell and tube exchanger. Okay, so what are the tubes? What are the tubes? Tubes will be like this here. Tubes will be like this. These are the many tubes, and then again, this is a tube. If you see the inlet for the tube side, see here, inlet for the tube side. Then again, I'll show 1 minute. I'll see the show the baffle over here, and then I'll show the baffle. So these are the baffles. Okay. Okay. See here. When it will enter, okay, I'll show. When you can see here, the tube will, okay, the fluid will enter. It will enter like this, right? It will enter like this, and see here, it will be not possible. So therefore, what I'll do, I'll give one parts partition plate over here. So therefore, you can see here, tube side fluid will be moving this way, and it is coming this way. Therefore, you have given two paths. See here, there is a restriction. I'll give a restriction over here. If you give a restriction, it has to pass through these tubes. The one tube means many tubes will be there. They will be passed through these tubes, and it will take a turn, and it will be coming down. So therefore, this is one tube. So you can see here, cell side arrangement will be like this. You can see here, and fluid will be passing this way. You can see here. How the fluid will be passing? I'll show with this color, different color. You can see here. Fluid is entering here. You can see here. There is a, it cannot pass. So therefore, it will take a turn, and then again it will be coming here, and then it is leaving. Okay. This is a representation of cell and tube heat exchanger. Okay. So please, all of you, draw this one. So this is tube side, it is T1. So this is T1, small T1. Here it is capital T1, capital T2. I hope you understood. So any confusion, please ask me. Try to understand what you are going to design. I am going to design 1-2 cell and tube. So therefore, you can see here, the pass will be, this will be passing through the tube, then it is taking a turn, and it is coming back. Okay, very simple. Okay, so I hope you understood this, and then I'll come to the data. Okay, given data, what is given? So identify what is a hot fluid. So please refer the screen and write it. Temperature of the hot fluid is always represented as T. So hot fluid will be represented as capital T. So therefore, this is ethylene glycol. So what is it? 120 to 103. So refer the problem carefully and write the values. Next, temperature of the cold fluid, which is represented as small t, toluene. So therefore, please highlight. So the hot fluid is, okay, ethylene glycol, and toluene is this one. So therefore, toluene is 27 and 23. So therefore, this is T1. This is T2. Here, to reduce the problem, always higher temperature for cold fluid, you write this as T1, this as T2, so that there is no question of taking a negative sign. Negative sign means reverse. I am reversing here. Okay. You can refer or write with a pencil. So therefore, next step, average temperature of the hot fluid. So how we'll write average temperature of hot fluid? So that will be 120 plus 103 divided by.
Sir, use different color pen.
Okay. Please tell me if you are not convinced. Please tell me. I cannot. Understand. So therefore, you will be on the other side. Please. Okay. Tell me if you have any problem. Yes, I'll change it. Okay. 1 minute. I'll change the color. Color red will be fine. Okay. So therefore, what is average temperature? I'll write 120 inlet hot plus 103 outlet, add these two. So there are two values, therefore I am taking the two. Average means how many are there? You have only two values. So if you do the average, that value is 111.5. Is it right? So please, all of you, use your calculator. One day you will forget to use your calculator. So similarly, you calculate a average temperature of a cold fluid. Average temperature is 63 plus 27. You have to show this. Okay, step also. You do it divided by 2. If you do this, I hope the temperature will be 45. So therefore, cold fluid means it is toluene. Hot fluid means it is ethylene glycol. Is it fine? Okay. Next, what is given? I hope if this is easy, you can easily understand. What is given? Mass flow rate of ethylene glycol is given. So it is given as 66,700 kg per hour of ethylene glycol. Therefore, what I am doing? I am doing this into kg per second. 66,700 divided by 3,600. So because 3,600 is the number of seconds present in the hour. So therefore, if you do it, 18.527 kg per second. Okay. Is it fine? Written. We'll proceed to the. Yeah. Tell me. Who is that? Any doubt? Any problem here? No. Shall I move to the next slide? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Come to the next slide. See here, before going to the next slide, see here, we have to calculate why we are taking the physical property. Physical property should be taken at an average temperature. So therefore, see here, if I'll take at temperature of 120, it will be here. If I'll take a temperature at 103, I am taking the physical property over here or here. So therefore, to reduce that, so therefore I'll take the average, because as soon as it will be entering, the temperature will be get reduces. So therefore, I am taking an inlet and outlet, and then I'll take a average property should be taken at the average temperature. Please try to write the average properties of a, write down average properties of hot and cold fluid will be taken at average temperatures. Okay, please. Okay, write down the properties of hot and cold fluid. The properties of hot and cold fluid will be taken at average temperature of hot and cold fluid or average temperatures. Therefore, we have calculated average temperature. I'll move to the next slide. Okay, before going to this, I want to show you the Perry handbook. So I have said, you have got, all of you got the Perry handbook with you? Please answer me. Okay. I have shared Perry handbook in the group. Have you downloaded it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, please. Okay, go through it. I'll show today. And then later, so if you are convenient with referring Perry handbook, it will be good. Otherwise, you will face a lots of difficulty. Okay, when you so move through the Perry handbook, okay, you can see here. So first pages, okay, you can see here. So write down the page numbers if you want on the rough book. I'll spend some time on the Perry handbook, because if it is a regular class, I would have come and attended individually to understand table. So therefore, I want to show it now only, so that it will be convenient later. I'll show all the pages, okay, during the problem solving. But today we will be using, see here, when you are coming to the first page, so this is the first page of conversion factors. So see here, when you are doing a design, so don't use any conversion by knowing what you knowing, okay, and what is in your mind. Don't multiply. All the conversion factors are given in a query handbook. Suppose if you have any confusion, come to this first pages. First pages will deals with the conversion. All the SI units are given. First, if you read it, all the basic units are given and their conversion is given. And if you move to the further, you can see here, length can be directly. Suppose if we have length feet 2 meter. So what is the multiplication factor? 3.014. Just multiply. And then see here, inch to centimeter, multiply by 2.5. So all the conversion factor. So conversion factor is a customary unit by the factor obtained by the SI. So therefore, you have to multiply. Just multiply length to millimeter. So multiply this 1.609 into, okay, 10 to the power of 0.1. Okay. If it is some factor, they will be given 10 to the power of minus 1. Okay. And suppose if you see area, you can directly convert the area. See here, if I want to have acre to the hectare, you can see here acre to hectare. So multiplication factor will be, yes, tell me.
Sir, this is different query.
I am not sharing. One minute. I'll share. Sorry. I forgot to share. One minute. I'm not sharing. Where is it? Okay, can you see now? All of you see now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you see here, first pages, these are the first section. It is called, okay, conversion factor with a mathematical symbol. So don't try to use your what you know the unit. Don't do it. So that will generate a large error. Okay, roughly will take. But when you come here, you can see here, they will be given a multiplication factor. If you want to convert a length, so feet to meter, multiply this by 3.048. You can see here, conversion factor, multiply customary unit. So if you want to convert from a mile to kilometer, this is a customary unit. Suppose if it is an area, I want this conversion from acre to hectare. You can see here, this is acre. I want to convert this into hectare. Just you can look at it, 4.046 into 10 to the power of minus 1. Automatically, you will get into acres. All the units, okay, volume, entire unit conversion is given. So no need to worry. So don't, so only you have to know how to use this, okay? All the, even you can see here, concentration, conversion, any unit, if you see, all the conversions are given. So no need to remember any conversion. But you should maintain the consistency of your conversion while doing the calculation. That is very, very important, right? Okay, so you can see here, so many units. He has covered whatever the unit, so which is required for all the engineering aspect. Okay, this is the conversion. Okay, next is metric unit conversion is given. And then you can see here. And all the metric unit conversion. And this is common units conversion. So usually we'll use a basic unit. So that unit conversion is also given. Suppose if you want to convert temperature into Kelvin, temperature plus 273. So temperature into Fahrenheit, 9/5 temperature in degree centigrade plus 32. So everything is available. Just you have to look into the Perry handbook. So everything you will get it. See here. Then here specific gravity with respect to their API is given. We'll discuss it later. Okay. And then if you come here, you can see here. So this is wire gas. So whatever the 14 BWG, 15 BWG, what we are discussing now, this is only. Okay. It is BWG. You can see here. Brigham gauge, WZ, wire gauge. Okay. Can you see this one? So it is a steel and US wire gauge. He has given Brigham wire gauge in this problem. If you come to the 14, see here, 14, he has given 14 BWG. Look at your problem statement today. He has given a 14 BWG. You can see the thickness. For thickness, for iron wire, for different value he has given. you can use this table to get the thickness. Okay, we'll see. So when you are using, okay, I'll show how to use it. Okay, I am not explaining. You can see here all the conversion is given. And later, see here, this is finished, basic. Physical and chemical data. Whenever you are looking at a toluene and a ethylene glycol, today we are discussing with a toluene and ethylene glycol. See here, all the basic properties of a toluene and ethylene glycol will be available here. Okay, so what you will get? Sometime if I'll say some limonene, limonene is not a regularly used component. You have to find its chemical formula and its composition. So that type of specialty chemicals will not be present. But whatever the chemicals, which generally they will produce at a larger scale, so that will be available. Okay, it will be classified as organic and inorganic also. What you can get? You can get a formula, you can get its weight and how it will be there in the color, and also their specific gravity. Specific gravity means it is density. Melting point will be given, boiling point will be given, it is solubility is also given. So you can easily understand. So their solubility. Solubility will play a very, very important role in doing a chemical processes. So therefore, this is a basic aspect. Immediately, if you don't know the formula, you will get a formula and then it's a composition. So this is the first page. Getting the, as you move, you'll get all the page numbers. There are, you can look at it, 2,471 pages. You can see here, 2,471 pages. Very difficult to show. So therefore, I have shown a basic step. Okay, coming to the problem. Okay, I'll share. Okay, just I have shown. Okay, I'll show all the pages as we go with the number of problem. Okay, definitely I'll show. So coming to the problem statement. Okay. And so we have done average temperature. So average temp, after taking average temperature, so first you have to calculate physical property of a hot and cold fluid. Okay, so look at it. So what is the physical property of hot and cold fluid? So coming to the density, see here. So please all of you draw this one. Okay, draw this table. Don't write the value. So don't write any value. Okay, don't write any value. So write the component ethylene glycol and toluene. So only write this one. Component ethylene glycol and toluene. So write and draw the table. So write and draw the table. I'll take one by one how to calculate. Okay. So component. You write it Cp. Even if you want to write temperature, average temperature, no problem. You can introduce here Cp, joules per kg Kelvin, viscosity kg per meter second, or Newton meter per second is also same, or poise is also same. Density is kg per meter cube. Thermal conductivity is watt per meter Kelvin, and mass flow rate is kg per second. It is kg per second. We have already calculated 18.527. Okay. So whatever the value you know, you write it. So what the value you know? Okay, I'll highlight. So I have calculated this. You write it. Only write those values. Don't write all the values. I have shown all the constructed physical property. So it is 18.525. This is ethylene glycol is given. So toluene mass flow rate you need to calculate. Okay, getting the ethylene glycol. What is given in the problem statement? Density is given. No need to calculate from the Perry handbook since it is given in the problem. Okay, please look at it. Okay, it is given. So 1045 ethylene glycol I have written here, and also 482.5, that is also given in the problem statement. So therefore, what you have to calculate now? Highlight that also. This is not given. You have to calculate. You don't know, so don't write this. Multiply whatever the into mark what I am showing. Don't enter into your graph. You have to get these values from a Perry handbook. I'll show how to get it. So whatever it is written, you write it. First, immediately after this, construct the component table. And then you start writing the values. first specific heat. Okay, I want to calculate specific heat of ethylene glycol and toluene. Have you done this table? Have you completed this table?
Yes.
Okay. Shall I move to the specific heat? I have already taken the table and then I have pasted here. Okay, see here. I'll show. If you have viscosity. Okay, 1 minute. I'll share the PERI handbook once again. Say it. So write down. Okay. Page number 2196. Okay. Specifically. Page number 2170. Table 2196. See here. Okay, so write down. So write down specific heat. So what is the heading? I'll write it here. Whatever I'll write, you want. Okay, write it here. Okay, I'll write it. So number one. So write first heading. You write it in your notebook. Physical properties of hot and cold fluid. Hot and cold fluid. So hot fluid means you should write number one, hot ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol and toluene. If you want to calculate ethylene glycol first, you do it. And if you want to calculate together, you do it. But I insist you to calculate separately. First ethylene glycol, later you take toluene. Okay, that is a better way to do the calculation. So therefore, what I'll do, I'll calculate only physical properties of a hot fluid. I'll write it here. Hot fluid, write like this. Hot fluid. And also there is no confusion. I'll write ethylene glycol. What is the ethylene hot fluid? Ethylene glycol. At what temperature you have to take? So that is at 111.4 degree centigrade. Okay, this is a heading. This is a heading. So therefore I'll write it. Okay. I want only first heading as physical property of a hot fluid. What is a hot fluid? Ethylene glycol. At what temperature we are taking? 111.4. Okay. Now I'll write number one. In that number one, specific heat, Cp. Heading is there. Therefore, I am writing all the properties of ethylene glycol. Refer. You have to write. Refer. Page. Refer page 2170. You can see here 2170. 2170. Table 196. Table 196. 2170. Table 196. I'll show that one. Okay. So you have to write. From PERI handbook. It is 7th edition. So PERI handbook, 7th edition. You have to write for all the data where you are taking from. So that is mandatory to write. So the data you have, where you have taken from. 7th edition. See here. Getting? See here. So this is 296. Okay, here it will start. See here, it is a inorganic and organic liquid. Okay, you can see here. Organic and inorganic liquid. You can see here 2196. Correct now, what I have written is 2196. It is 2196. You have to write like this. This is a table. I'll highlight this one. You have to write the table to 196, and page number it will start from here, 169. So therefore it is, next page is 217, right? This page, right? And then search your ethylene glycol here. Okay, so you can go on searching the ethylene guy. You got it? Any confusion over here? Any confusion? Yeah, Laksh.
Sir, why we need to take temperature as 114.0?
Average temperature, you already calculated. The physical property should be taken at average temperature. You joined now or from the beginning?
So I joined a little late, sir.
That's right. Okay. See here. So when you are taking an inlet and outlet, see here, ethylene glycol is hotter. It is entering at, I'll tell you, it is entering at 120 and leaving at 103. So therefore, you have to add 120 plus 103 divided by 2. So that will be 111.4. So therefore, I am taking the temperature at average. Okay. Taking the physical property at average temperature. Clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, I got it.
Okay. Fine. Okay. You first, what I am searching for? I am searching for ethylene glycol. You come here. Ethylene glycol, I already know. So I'll go to it. I think 95 number, please check. See here, 95 is a ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol. Okay. So write down the component number is 95. For your reference, you can write on the top. Component number is 95. You can see here, I can get the ethylene. All the things you will get it. See here, so many things are there. Okay. So, but I am interested in the ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol molecular formula can also be seen here. C2H6O2. Okay. So now what are these values? So because CP will not be available directly. So therefore, these are the values of, see here, I'll come. It is, first one is chemical, okay, abstract sheet. Okay, this is a number. Okay, this chemical number is not required. So molecular weight is not required for us. See here, you have to leave this one. C1 you have to write, C2 you have to write, C3 you have to write, C4 you have to write, C5 you have to write. First write this one, okay? I'll come to it. See here, I don't want this. I don't want this. What you want? C1. Ethylene glycol, C1, please all of you write. C1 is equal to. Write C1 is equal to what? I'll zoom it. 3.554 into 10 to the power of 4. C1 is 3.554 into 10 to the power of 4. What is C2? 4.3678 into 10 to the power of 2. Into 10 to the power of 2. C2 is equal to. Next, you write down C3 is equal to. So this is C3 is equal to what? C3 is equal to minus 1.8486 into 10 to the power of minus 1. 10 to the power of minus 1. Minus 1.8486 into 10 to the power of minus 1. And C4 is a 0. C4 is equal to 0. C5 is equal to 0. Okay. So please, you can refer. I am taking on the same line. C4 is equal to 0, C5 is equal to 0. I hope you have written, all of you written? Yes? Written or not? Yes. Okay, how to use these values? You have written C1, C2, C3, C4, C5. So when you take, okay, refer any table, you always refer below the table. Below the table, the instruction will be given how to use these values, okay? Come down, you can look at it. So it is end of the table. You will be getting a new table here. So it is organic solids. Liquids are more solid. So therefore, this is the end of the table. Come to end of the table. So there are equations which will be given specific here. Okay, see here. You can see equation 1, equation 2. See here. Nothing is mentioned. See here. Otherwise, you can take equation 1, C1, C2T should be used except otherwise specified, means nothing is specified. I can always take this Getting now? I am highlighting and then I am again erasing. So write the formula. Are you getting it? Otherwise, I'll highlight. Highlight this one. Sorry. I'll highlight this line. Okay, so only second line equation. I'll zoom it. Equation one, heat capacity can be calculated C1 plus C2 into T plus C3 T square plus C4 T cube plus C5 T4. Right? What is the unit you will get? Joules per kilomole Kelvin. Please remember. So, what is the unit of this? This will be joules per kilomole. It is, that is also given. Kilomole Kelvin unit. So write this equation. Okay. And please remember, all the K should be in terms of Kelvin. And K should be, so write this equation. Heat capacity is C1, C2, T. C3 T square, C4 T cube, C5 T to the power of 4. The what is the unit? Joules per kilomole Kelvin unit. So temperature should be introduced as a Kelvin. So therefore add plus 273 to the temperature. So can you write? So C1. So temperature is 111.4, I think, plus 273. So therefore, this is a temperature you have to use in the equation and tell me the value what you are getting in joules per kilomole Kelvin. So this will be 384. I think you have to, temperature is 384.5. It is not 4. I think it is 5 or 4.
384.4.
4. This is T. You have to introduce T here. You have a C1 value, you have a C1 value, C2 value, C3 value, C4 is 0, C5 is 0. No need to consider because multiply by 0 is 0. Only C2, C3, T. First, you have to write this equation, introduce, and then calculate. So tell me what is the value you are getting joules per kilomole Kelvin. Your value of specific heat will be, I'll write the value. Please verify 176.1 52.1614. So what is the unit? Joules per kilomole Kelvin. Kilomole to kg, what you do? You divide by molecular weight of ethylene glycol. So divide this by molecular weight of ethylene glycol. So you'll get joules per kg. So because you'll get a kg per kilomole, because this unit will be having a kg per kilomole, right? Kg per kilomole. These will be get cancels, this and this. So you'll get in joules per kg Kelvin. So therefore Cp will be, Cp will be 2841.1639 joules per kg Kelvin. Joules per kg Kelvin. So please, all of you check, verify whether you are getting it or not. If you have any confusion, please ask me. Okay, any questions? Any question? Are you getting these values? Yes or no?
Sir, heat capacity, I'm getting different, sir. Heat capacity, sir, it's 176122.69.
No, please verify. Verify once again. This is the correct, exactly right. What I have calculated. So anybody is getting? So verify with your any friend.
Sir, cross check.
Okay, some other answer. Anybody is getting this value? You can see here 95, no? Come to 95. So this is 62. You can see here. 62 is a molecular weight. Therefore, I am dividing this by molecular weight. Okay, 62. And come to the calculation part. See the calculation part. Okay, so Rishabh, your voice is not audible. Yeah, you are getting can you type? Can you type what is a doubt? Because you have to attend next class also, right? I have to end the meeting. Okay, so we'll discuss, you raise that question in the next class, okay? I'll continue in the next class, okay?
Sir.
Yeah, tell me fast. Yeah.
How you take that 176.15?
No, it is calculation. No, after calculating this one, I am asking this only. C1 plus C2 multiply by temperature, C3 multiply by this square, you do it, you fill this one, use this equation. And after you are you get this answer. I told, no, I explained, use this equation and introduce T as 384.4. C1 you know, C2 you know, calculate, multiply by 384.4, C3 you know, C4, C5, all the values. And if you calculate, you will get this. So joules per kilomole Kelvin. Therefore, I want in joules per kg, divide this by molecular weight, you will get 2841.1639. Please, all
of you. The value of that CP is getting different.
You verify once again. Okay, use your calculator properly. Whatever it is calculated is right. And again, you try in your home. We'll discuss in the next class. You have to attend other classes also. Okay, so we'll discuss. So Rishabh is getting the same answer. Okay, please verify once again. Okay? Check your and then your calculator. You have to fix with the fourth digit. So fourth digit, okay, second digit, third digit will change the value. So therefore, you round off the fourth digit, okay? Rounding off is there in your calculator, you fix it. So therefore, the same answer you will get it, okay? We'll verify in the next class. Thank you. Thank you very much for attending today's class.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.